Homie, don't play that. Amen. Amen. Wow. Yeah. Amen. Happy Resurrection Day. Wow. Listen, I'm not out here with no stick. So I'm just gonna do it one more time. He did a lot for you. He did a lot for all of us. Happy Resurrection Day. Amen. Amen. He is not there. Amen. He is risen. Amen. Yes. All powerful. Amen. So before I get started, I'm going to let my wife come up.
Thank you, baby. Hallelujah. He is risen. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Trudy, and I head up the food and family here at Full Armor. Every Wednesday, we have a meal. This Wednesday, we'll be having meatloaf, green beans, mashed potatoes, and I'm going to do a pineapple upside-down cake for dessert. It's $5 a plate or $20 for your immediate family. So you can register online. We have a church app here, a church Tithely app. You can register there. The mama in me does not like saying this, but the Jesus in me says it's okay for me to say it. If you don't register, you don't eat. Amen. So there you go. Love y'all.
Amen. Amen. And just speaking on that, man, her and Heather, they do a lot to get that food ready. And so everybody that they're buying food for is people that registered. And those people went through the process. And it's not fair for those that went through the process not to eat because you didn't go through the process. Amen. So we're just asking everybody to follow the process and get on the Church Tithely app and register. It's real easy. I mean, it takes less time than what you spend on TikTok and Facebook just scrolling. Amen. Amen. So I want to speak. I got a couple of things I got to talk about. And one of them is we're having baptisms next week. So if you want to be baptized, please get with the pastor and let us know so then I can get with Joseph and get your shirt size and all of that. We're doing it next week. Amen. And then what else? That's it? What was that? Amen. I see him looking back at me. Man, I'm going to tell you, man, I came in this morning and I seen Joseph come through that door and he had a tie on. I said, man, God does perform miracles. Amen. God does perform miracles. He cleaned up pretty good. Amen. Yes, yes. We're all going to get some. Keep playing. Keep playing. Tyler started that with me. Well, we want to say hello and good morning to all our church family online. Happy Resurrection Day to you guys also. So I just want to speak real quick because I know what today's the significance of today is. But what we did yesterday at the park is very symbolic to that. First and foremost, I want to thank everybody that came out there and they donated or did whatever they did. We thank you guys so much for all of that. I want to thank Pampa Tire and Glass. I know he doesn't like me doing this, but I need to thank them. And I want to thank them for what they did for us. So they did a train ride, and all the donations, all the proceeds went to the community chaplain for the ROAR program. And I know you guys know that I've been dealing with the fires, but that's not my only ministry. My ministry is to help our community. I'm reaching out and restoring them and helping them in any way we can. So we were able to raise $243. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Amen. It's for real. I mean, for just people giving stuff, or just giving it away because of the board that we had posted, man, that meant a lot to me, you know. I talked to the pastor this morning when we got that money, and I told him we were using that for the bus. I think there's nothing more that says to our community at large that us as a church body cares about you and we want to see you come here if you want to come. So we're putting that money, and if anybody wants to add to that, because we got to get the tag, the title, and all of that, please just make a donation and put a bus on the envelope, and Heather make sure it gets to the place where it needs to get to so we could actually get this on the road, man. I'm ready to do it. I'm tired of just seeing it there on the side of the building like that, and I know some of you guys also feel like that, so please come alongside of us and join. And thank you again, Pampa Tire and Glass, for all your support in the ministry. Amen. Thank you, guys, for real. For real. I wish we could all just get behind each other and just support each other like that, regardless, without no agenda. Amen. So I'm going to read out of Matthew 28, and I'm going to read out of verse 5. I know you guys, everybody's seen this today on their church apps, if you got them, or reading them in your Bible because of what today is. And it's established our faith. Amen. For us that weren't alive when Jesus was walking, it establishes our faith. It gives us our faith. So it says, the angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen." Amen. Just like second service. Amen. Boy, y'all in the second service, y'all know what it was? Amen. I just got a different passion, and I'm not, listen, when you come near death, you have a lot to be grateful for when you're standing on the other side, standing up. Amen? So, forgive me for that. So, he is not here. He is risen. Just as he said, come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead, and he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you. And I know we go over that every year. Or however times you read the Bible in a year or in a day or in a month, you always go over that. And for me, the Lord just highlighted something different. And I want to give this to you today. I just want to share it because I think it's something that it is repeated time and time and time again. And I think just in our human understanding, we just look over it and we really don't see it or feel it or recognize it. And we just living life as the way we live it. But what the Lord highlighted for me is that he said, he has risen from the dead, and he's going ahead of you. And I think some of you guys really need to let that soak in and really sit, because the Lord is always ahead of you. The Lord is always ahead of you. He called you before you even knew of him. He knew you from way back. And he still called you. And what he's calling you into, he already knew you was qualified for that, because he qualifies us. Yeah. Amen. So always remember, when you're walking and doing the things that you are doing, I'm telling you not to look back. Because when you're looking back, you can't see what's ahead of you. And what's ahead of you is the Lord calling you to do things for his kingdom and to be kingdom-minded people. Amen. So just please stand up with me as we get ready for service. And you know, I read that this morning, and this morning the praise and worship was getting ready to come up here, and they were getting ready to do a song. And the Lord just highlighted something for me, because Joseph was looking at Russell, and they were getting ready to do the song. And Joseph looked at Russell, and he gave him this nod that, like, yeah, it's your time to come in. But the Lord just showed that to me, like, the Lord gives us that nod, too. That when we're looking towards him, that we're looking at him for what we're doing or about to do or what he's leading us into, the Lord is just shaking his head, telling you, yeah, do it. Yeah, do it. Yeah, do it. Amen. Amen. I know you guys are just coming in here, and you guys are just waking up, and you guys are just getting your senses about you and all of that, man. But listen, I just don't want this to be another church service that you just check off, man. Today should have more significant meaning in your life. It's like putting a stake in the ground. Let today be that stake in your ground that says, Lord, no matter what I do, no matter what I don't do, I'm going to commit myself to you. I'm going to commit myself to do the things that you've called me to do. And if you take away everything else, calling, church, all of that, if you take everything else away, he's called you to the same thing, that one core foundation thing, and that's to have a relationship with him. Have a relationship with him, because that's what he died for, so he could have a relationship with you, that you are in right standing, that you are righteous, that the way you stand right now, no matter how you see yourself, it's not the way that God sees you. When he sees you covered by the blood of his son. So you're perfect when he sees you. You are perfect. And I need you to understand that. The enemy's got in our heads so tough, so hard that you can't even move yourself through that nonsense because you rather listen to it or the enemy than to believe what God is saying about you and what God has called you to and what God's already healed you from. Amen. You rather believe the lie than the truth. And as we get ready to do praise and worship today, and I was telling the pastor this earlier after we got done with this first service, man, and the Lord just said this loud and clear to me, and I'm speaking to the person that the Lord is going to draw. This altar is always open. And when you come to this altar, I know the religious people that are here will look at you and say, oh, he must have did something wrong. I don't care about those people. I'm looking to the people that know that when we get called to the altar, we're being called to it because this is our meeting place for us and the Lord. Yeah. It has nothing to do about judgment, but everything about praising and worshiping our true and living God, the one that died for you and rose for you on the third day, the one that God sent down to die for your sins. So what I'm telling you today is if the Lord is drawing you to this altar, if the Lord is drawing you to the altar, Don't let whatever you have in your head put brakes on you from not walking up here. Because the Lord's trying to have a meeting place with you. And I mean that wholeheartedly. I can speak of that because me, just like there's a whole lot of other people that have been in here, we've been in prison, literal prison. And some of you think just because you ain't been in prison that you've never been in a prison. You live in a prison each and every day, and it's called your mind. It ain't gotta be TDCJ. It ain't gotta be Oklahoma. It ain't gotta be a Florida DOC. It ain't gotta be none of that. I did 21 years and 5 months in that. I know what it is to be in prison. But I also know what the word says. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And he's trying to get you to receive that freedom. So get yourself out the way today. And as we get ready to praise and worship, get out your own way and let God do what he's going to do and just come to the altar. There's going to be people praying for you. Ain't no judgment coming here. The people that come and lay hands on you, we ain't judging you. We've been where you've been. We've gone through what you've gone through. We've been through the fire. We don't smell burnt, but that's just because of the anointing that the Lord has on us. Amen? Amen. We rocking tonight. We rocking today. Amen. And tonight, every day, every day. Listen, I love you guys and thank you guys so much. So Heavenly Father, we just thank you and we praise you for today, Father God, because today like no other day, Lord, we know today we see it as the day that you've risen from the dead, that the tomb was open, Father God, and that you didn't even have to open that tomb. You did it for the naysayers. You did it for the liars. We knew you did it just to establish our belief in you, Father God. That door you opened, that stone that you rolled was the door signifying for our spiritual lives to receive you, that door is open for us to come in. We want to come into you, Father God. We want to come into the most holy of holies. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for not only having your way in us, doing the things that you're doing in us, but just living in us. We thank you for that. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for having your way in this service and in us and through us. Let this aroma be a sweet smell to you, Father God, and have your way in us and anoint the pastor's word today, Father God. Let us all hide behind the cross each and every day, that we would decrease and you would increase in us, Father God. And we just thank you for today, and we thank you for this word. And we know that's not going to fall on dead soil. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
No other king could vanquish the war horse or silence the warrior's rage while riding the lowly back of a donkey. No other king could break the dominion of darkness, the tyranny of evil, with a reign of grace and a kingdom of peace. No other king could give his life for the redemption of rebels, his wealth to welcome the outcast. Jesus is that king. King of glory, Son of the living God. Not just another king, not just another prophet, not just another teacher. He was the one the world had been waiting for. The one to deliver us from captivity, the son of David and Abraham's chosen seed. He is the goal of the Mosaic Law, Yahweh in the flesh. He is the one to establish God's reign and rule, to heal the sick, give sight to the blind, freedom to the prisoners, and proclaim good news to the poor. This Jesus was the Creator come to earth and the beginning of a new creation. He embodied the covenant, fulfilled the commandments, and reversed the curse. This Jesus is the Christ that God spoke of to the serpent, the one prefigured to Noah in the flood, the one promised to Abraham, the one guaranteed to Moses before he died, the one promised to David during his reign, the one revealed to Isaiah as a suffering servant, the one predicted through the prophets and prepared for through John the Baptist. He is the Father's Son, Savior of the world, and substitute for our sins. More loving, more holy, and more wonderfully terrifying than we ever thought possible. He is our Jesus, and there is no other king like him. He is our God, our glory, our victorious Savior. There is no other king like him. There is no other king.
Without hope, with no place to begin. Love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given. Morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with.
having church. Amen. Did everybody get their communion? If you can sit down if you'd like during this, we're going to take communion. Communion's a time of remembering what Jesus did for us. And especially here at Easter, during the Last Supper with the disciples, he broke bread with them. And he said, "This do in remembrance of me." And one of the things I thought about is the disciples couldn't remember the crucifixion and resurrection because it hadn't happened yet. They had not experienced that yet. But we know the end from the beginning. The scripture in Isaiah 53:5-6 says, "He was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our wickedness, our sin, our injustice. The punishment required for our well-being fell on him, and by his stripes we are healed. But the Lord has caused the wickedness of us all, our sin and injustice, to fall on him instead of us." I love that last part. Instead of you. He took your sin and put it on Jesus and put it on the cross. You don't have to carry that. His body took the weight of all the sin so we could be made whole physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Through the stripes from the whip he endured to the piercing of his feet and hand and the piercing in his side. Let's go ahead and take the bread. 1 Peter 1:18 says, "For you know you were not redeemed from your useless, spiritually unproductive way of life." I love the Amplified. "Inherited from your forefathers with things like silver and gold. But you were actually purchased, bought with precious blood like that of a sacrificial lamb, unblemished and spotless, the priceless blood of Christ. His blood washes us clean from our sins. We confess our sins and we forgive forgiveness through Jesus. His blood gives us that new life." Let's go ahead and take the cup. I'm going to pray. Father, I thank you for your sacrifice. I thank you that you sent your only son and that you placed all of my sin, all of our sin, on Jesus, who was innocent. I thank you that he bore our sin. He bore our griefs and our sorrow. He bore all of our sickness and our disease. I thank you that we can now walk free, delivered, and whole through you. And I just ask that this morning that you, Holy Spirit, would come and that you, if there's anyone here that does not know you in the sound of my voice, that you would draw them by your Spirit. And we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Some say madman, some say king. Wonder-working rebel priest. Jesus Christ the Nazarene. He knew well what it would take to free us all from sin and grave. Perfect man would have to die, and only he could pay that price. Friday's good 'cause Sunday's coming. Don't lose hope 'cause Sunday is coming. Devil, you're done, you better start running. Friday's good 'cause Sunday is coming. So he let those soldiers take him in, as his friend betrayed him with a kiss. There before the mocking crowd, like a lamb to the slaughter, didn't make a sound. To Calvary, and he shed his blood for set us free. As the nails went in and the sky grew dark, the redemption of the world was on his heart. Friday's good 'cause Sunday is coming. Don't lose hope 'cause Sunday is coming. Devil, you're done, you better start running. Friday. Sunday is coming.
From above, I've got miracles on miracles.
even, I can't even count them all. 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 Miracles, a million little miracles. Miracles on miracles. Count your miracles. 1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all. Miracles on miracles. A million little miracles. Miracles on miracles. Count your miracles, 1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all. 1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all.
Just be quiet. There's times that we need to be quiet. I'm reminded of that movie that I don't know what movie it is, but there was this movie that said, "This is what you're doing. This is what I want you to do." There's a lot of times we get in our own head and listen to what we're saying and what other people are saying. We need to be quiet and listen to what God says. I'm gonna kind of steal from Mike a little bit. We need to be quiet and consider Jesus, what Jesus did for us. Today, there's probably going to be a lot of activities going on around your houses. Just take a moment today to be still and be quiet and understand what today really means. Avoid all the chaos for a few moments. And just praise Jesus for what he did on the cross. Today's a celebratory day, but that doesn't mean we can't stop and listen to what he's telling us. God, this morning I want to thank you for what you did on the cross, for sending Jesus to rescue us, because we couldn't do it on our own. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 He's risen. Amen.
Yeah.
All right. We're glad to see you all this morning. I know some of you were standing because there wasn't room or there wasn't a seat for you at that moment, but the kids are gone and they're not coming back anytime soon, so steal one of their seats. It'll be all right. We made a decision a long time ago to worship with our kids in the sanctuary, and we're not going to change that. And we made that decision because your kids need to see you worshiping the Lord, right? They need to see you go to the altar. They need to experience that. And that's when they learn to pray, is when they see Marshall at the altar, right? And when they see Marshall at the altar praying for somebody, that's when they know I can go pray for somebody too, right? And so we make that a big deal around here. Well, anyways, glad that you're here on Easter Sunday. If it's your first time with us or your first time in a long time, look over at your neighbor and say, he's going to give us a message today. And it ain't going to be religious at all. Amen. Yeah, I needed you to go ahead and get that out of the way, because I know a lot of people think, well, I'm going to go to church Easter Sunday so I can get my religious duty out of the way. This ain't about religion, right? And if that's what you thought you come to hear, you came to the wrong place.
Amen.
Right? It actually, for me, it's really exciting. You know, sometimes as a pastor, you just feel like you're doing this alone. And I know that sounds crazy to people. You got all these people here. Yeah, but sometimes you feel like you're doing it alone. And it's really cool on Easter for me, because it's amazing this weekend that when I really think about it, that literally, millions and millions of other Jesus followers and hundreds of thousands of churches all over the globe gather together to celebrate the greatest event in the history of the world. And we talked about the resurrection on Sunday or on Wednesday, and we didn't talk about the resurrection from just a place of because I said so. We talked about facts. We talked about not only what the Bible says about the resurrection, but the evidence surrounding the resurrection. And so we had a really good time with that. And then, on 3 days after the death of Jesus, the stone was rolled away, and we know the tomb was empty. It's very interesting that when you start looking at some of those things, just from a evidence perspective, all right? In order for the body to be coming up missing, then you would be calling the Roman government stupid. Yep. You don't have to get quiet. It's okay to say amen because that's the truth, amen. Right? And the Roman government were not stupid people, right? They put a seal on that tomb that said that tomb is sealed. That's what it said. And when they got there on the third day, the tomb was empty. Amen. That's what the tomb was. When what? When they rolled the stone away to look inside. Right? And so I think it's important to understand that, right? Because the world's not getting easier, the world's getting harder. Right? And it doesn't take much to see that just out there on the streets. It's ridiculous. Right? Now, I'm going to insert something here today. I don't care because we're live. And if I hear that phone again, I'm going to break it in half. I'm not even joking. That's a regular one, and I get tired of it. Sorry. If I can silence mine, you can silence yours for a little while. It won't hurt you. It's rude, and it's not okay. There you go. I said it. And if that's hard, just wait till I get going because I'm not even started yet. I mean, listen, yesterday our president decided, you know, I wasn't going to talk about this, but I'm angry. Yesterday he decided to endorse Transgender Day instead of the fact that Jesus Christ had risen from the dead. And I'm not okay with that. And if you are, I need to go ahead and tell you something now. You're in the wrong church building because I'm just not. I'm not putting up with it. How's that? Okay? And today is the day that I celebrate my Lord and Savior's resurrection, and I'm going to make absolutely sure that I do good by Him. Yeah. Right? Yeah. If I have to do that alone. Come on. Right? Amen. So on Mark 16:6, He says, "Don't be alarmed," He said. "You are looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid Him." Now I want you to understand something crystal clear, because if you can't grab a hold of this one truth, it'll be the hardest time for the rest of your life, especially trying to follow a God that you don't even know. That's the truth for your life. But He's not here, right? But because He's not here, I am here. And because I'm here, I'm going to worship Him. And I'm going to give this day to the Lord to do so. I mean, if you go back and think about it for just a minute, there was a whole group that opposed Him. Right? We talked about them on Palm Sunday. Right? They waved palm branches until He realized that they didn't represent what they wanted. And when they didn't get what they wanted, they shouted, "Crucify Him." That's what they did. And so He was brutally beaten, and placing Him on a cross to die after He was dead, they placed Him in the sealed tomb with guards. And on the third day, Resurrection Sunday, which is today, they rolled the stone away with witnesses present, and He was gone. Amen. Right? That doesn't matter what you think about it. It doesn't matter how you feel about it, folks. He was gone. And I assume that if you're here today, you're at least interested in what does that mean for the rest of my life. Well, let me tell you what it means. John 3:16 tells us. He said, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son." You got two of them, bro. Be honest. I do too. I wouldn't give up half of one of mine for some of this nonsense I see going on. I'm just being honest. I wouldn't. I wouldn't. For all of you who are raising sons, I want you to think about that for just a minute. He gave up His only Son, that whoever believes in Him, believes in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, should not perish but have everlasting life. Amen. Amen. Well, I've been doing okay so far without Him. No, you hadn't. You've been white-knuckling it. You don't understand why you're on your third marriage. Or your fourth divorce, or your fourth whatever. You just don't understand all of that. Because the truth is you're not following Jesus. We don't do the little cute stuff around here on Easter. My wife, first year ever, preached my Easter sermon. She said, "My goodness, honey, I hope they come back next Sunday." I don't have fun at Easter, because here's what I know: a man died and sacrificed his life. He had never committed a sin in his entire life, and he took all of my sins to a criminal's cross and died a criminal's death so that I could call it good. No, thank you. Here's what I know for a fact. He gave me my marriage back. He gave me two fine young men as sons, and he gave me another grandson, because I just believe this, that he saw I was doing good with the two boys I had, so he gave us a third one. Amen. I do. Amen. There you go. So I want to get back on topic, because I really want to get somewhere. But in fact, at the end of our life, I have to be honest with you. At the end of our life, the only thing that is going to matter to you, the only thing that will absolutely make a difference, is if you believed in your heart that Jesus Christ is the risen God, right? And confessed Him with your mouth, right? So here's what I would encourage you to do throughout the next few minutes of this service. Start practicing confessing Jesus, right? That's what needs to happen. Because we've gotten really good at confessing everything else and asking where He can fit into our little nonsensical mess that we've created, and He's never going to fit into that mess. There's no question bigger today than the one that I just asked you, and it kind of goes like this: what does it take to be made right with God? It's the question that everybody wants to know, but everybody's scared to ask. And if you ask the question today, honestly, outside of these four walls, you're going to get all sorts of different answers. And some of those answers are going to be, let me just say this, and it doesn't matter what your spiritual background is like, it doesn't matter how your grandparents raised you, it doesn't matter anything, we live in a spiritual melting pot today, and we're just asked to accept it all. That's where you shake your head, because I'm exactly right. Okay? We place a real high value as a people on tolerance, right? Everybody gets a trophy. Everybody's a winner. No, they're not all winners. According to the Bible, some of them are losers. Well, that's not nice, Pastor Mike. Find you a church that puts up with that nonsense, because the Bible doesn't. And so, we just place a high value on it. It's common today for people to believe things like all roads really lead to God. If you don't believe me, ask Oprah Winfrey. She says it. It doesn't really matter what you believe as long as you're sincere. That's a lie from the pits of hell, and will send you to hell. All world religions are essentially the same anyways. No, they're not. They're not even close to the same. You're supposed to coexist with Mike. Show that to me in the Bible. It doesn't say coexist. That's not what it says. The Bible tells us that is not the case in all situations. We aren't here today talking about a religion, yours or mine. We are here today talking about a relationship. Say Jesus. That's who we're talking about today. And anything else you want is outside of that. Okay? That's what we're talking about. Until you get your mind focused and get your life reset on Jesus Christ and nothing else, then the rest of it doesn't matter. For me, I've told most of you my testimony, and I'm not going to share it this morning, but I need you to understand this one part. On a Sunday morning, when a pastor asked me to go to church, he wasn't asking me to go to Celebration Fellowship or the International Pentecostal Holiness Church. He was asking me if I would consider going to his church and hanging out with him and having a donut and a cup of coffee because my wife was out of town. And I said yes. And I went into that church expecting something, and what I found, there was a man named Jesus Christ. And he changed my life forever. I left the Baptist church and became a Pentecostal because the Lord Jesus Christ saved me in a Pentecostal church. So I didn't decide to come Pentecostal first and then Jesus comes second. I chose Jesus and the rest followed after that. Right? That's when I lost my tongue from cussing. That's when I stopped drinking. That's when my marriage began to heal itself. That's when everything in my life changed. It's when I lost all of my friends. Yes, you lose all of those too. Amen. Yeah. When you make a decision, oh no, Pastor Mike, you should have more friends. No, because when you start following Jesus with a serious heart, all of a sudden everybody's like, oh, so they really do like follow him like that. Yes, sweetheart, we really do. We really do, every single day, right? And I'm okay with it. But there's just a bunch of different beliefs, and all of those beliefs really don't mean anything unless we get the salvation part right. In Acts chapter 4, verse 12, he says, there is salvation in no one else, no one else, no one. God has given no other name under heaven by which men, and I underline that and put it in red for you, must be saved. So in other words, get the salvation part right and you'll get the rest right. And if you get that wrong, you got the whole thing wrong. Amen. Right? So, y'all okay?
Amen.
Thank you, Nelson, for sitting on the front row and amen and every now and then.
Amen, brother.
Listen, I have to be honest, I'm not really here for the amen. It's his day.
Amen.
It's his day. And I want us to get that part right. And if you don't get that part right, to be honest with you, I'm the one that worries myself sick about it. Let me tell you why. Because all of those little stack of welcome home cards, you know, those visitor cards y'all fill out when you first got here, I keep those for a long time. And I pray over them and I watch them until I've seen you here for a certain amount of time. And then I go through them, and then if I realize somewhere along the way, Nelson's shaking his head because he knows it's true. And then if I see that you've missed a few times, I send you another text, right? And then when I send you the second text and you send me back your excuses, that's when I rip up your card and realize you're not coming back because you're just full of excuses, not full of Jesus.
Amen.
I do. Yeah, seriously. I do. Because here's the truth, I want to spend time on the people the Lord wants me to spend time with, helping to build them up, helping to strengthen them. I'm not interested in that other stuff, right? I don't believe for one second that he died on the cross for my ignorance.
Come on.
No, I don't. He died on the cross for my sins.
Yes.
But the Bible says not so I could continue in sin, but so that my sins would be forgiven. That's what the Bible says. And if you believe it some other way, you believe it some other way. I'm here today to talk about Jesus, not your brand of religion.
Amen.
How's that? Is that okay? Because I was raised Baptist. I know the once saved, always saved. I know all of that. Right? So I'm good with all of that. I've done many funerals for the lost. I've actually done funerals for the lost. My very first funeral, I got to tell you this real quick because it's kind of funny. Not really. It's kind of sad. The very first funeral I did was for a man who was a biker, and he was in trouble with the law because he was transporting. And y'all have another trafficking. I was trying to think of the word. And so he decided to take an 8-ball of meth, or whatever you call that thing, but it was the largest amount. And he took the 8-ball of meth and he exploded his heart while he was going down the road at over 120 miles per hour. That's the absolute truth on a motorcycle. There was nothing but parts and pieces left. His wife sat in front of me in my office. He was a very influential construction man. His wife sat in front of me in my office and she said, Pastor Mike, thank you so much for doing my husband's funeral. At the burial side service, I actually gave him the wrong name. That's how little I knew him. I didn't know him. And she said, this is what I need you to do for me. I knew the service was going kind of weird because she was acting kind of squirrely. And she said, his grandchildren are going to be at that funeral service. And I need you to make sure that they know that he's in heaven. And I said, has he ever confessed the Lord as his Lord? No, sir, he hasn't. And I said, ma'am, he's not in heaven.
Amen.
And I can't put him there.
Amen.
And she said, well, at least we know he's gone on to a better place. He's not suffering anymore. Let me tell you what the Bible says about that. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, there is nothing left for you but hell, with wailing and gnashing of teeth. And watch this, fireman in the back, unquenchable fire. Y'all been there, hadn't you? Right? Y'all know what I'm talking about. Man, I'm glad y'all are here today. We appreciate all that y'all did for the fires and all. We really do. You know, I don't take that lightly. It's an honor to have first responders in the house, right? At least we know if the church sets on fire, we know where they are, right? Amen. We at least got them for a little while, right? So, and shortly after doing that, I mean, I've done counseling sessions. I do counseling sessions with countless people. Then they all can do is make excuses about the messes in their lives. And this is what I always tell them. I tell them all the same thing. Turn your heart over to the Lord, because until you turn your heart over to the Lord, I can't do anything to help you. The first conversation is not about what's broken in your life. It's about how can we fix it. And the only way that we can fix it is through Jesus Christ. There is no alternative. There is none. Amen. I got to recover my thoughts here for a second. I'll tell the firemen a cool story in the back of the room, just because I want them to hear this, because this is the Lord that I serve. When the Pentecostal religion started, the Pentecostal holiness, or the holiness which we are, when that movement started, it started in California. And the sign still stands there today. It was held in a horse barn. It was originally a stable back before the cities were built. And they had revivals there. And the Holy Spirit broke out on a regular basis. And when the Holy Spirit broke out, there are several reports where they sent firemen to put the flames out that they could see coming out of the roof of the building. This is an absolute true story. It's in the historical books. And they could see the flames coming out of the rooftop. And it was called the Azusa Street Revival. But this is what it said in the news people, in the newspaper article. Many firemen went in, but few came out, the rest having received the power of the Holy Spirit. That's a quote from the newspaper. I just think that story is really cool.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And then look where we are as a church today. So, anyways, I better get back on, because this is the guy that we're going to talk about for just a few minutes today. We're going to talk about Jesus, and I'm going to try to calm back down for a little bit. But what's interesting to me is in the world today, everybody wants to debate the spiritual things, higher powers, higher beings, but nobody wants to talk about Jesus, right? We want to give everybody this, and a lot of times throughout the year, I do try to give you some stuff that you can live off of, some stuff that'll change your mind, some stuff that'll change your life. But the truth is, on Easter Sunday here, we're going to talk about Jesus. That's all we're going to talk about. And if you really want to make things controversial, that's all you have to do is mention his name. And all of a sudden, it gets real controversial. Right? Seriously, you can talk about the spiritual things all day long, and that's not the controversy. But for the most part, the world accepts, at least acknowledges, Jesus lived out, but many are scared to publicly proclaim him because it may offend someone. You know, we don't want to offend anyone. You can't talk about Jesus at your job anymore, right? You can talk about witches, and you can talk about rocks, and you can talk about yoga, and you can talk about everything else, but you better not talk about Jesus, right? I mean, when my wife was subbing for the high school, I thought at one time, that's a good job for me. I'll become a sub with my wife. And she said, no, you can't. And I said, why? And she said, because you would be kicked out for proselytizing about the Lord. and I would. And I was like, seriously, that's a thing? And she said, yes, honey, that's a thing. But we like to see ourselves as good moral people, right? I mean, we like to be sure that our neighbors saw us doing something good and, you know, that we're good people. And, you know, when the red light turns green, you let others go first, you know, and stop sign, you come on, go, thank you, have a blessed day, amen, right? And we like to be good moral people. I mean, we do, right? I mean, we love the book of Matthew because the book of Matthew just tells you how to live a moral life. That's what it does, Matthew, the 25th chapter. It's just a good moral book, right? You're called to be salt of the earth. What does that mean? Well, it means you don't cuss people out, right? You try to be loving and you try to be careful and, you know, and just, well, someone just be careful. Some of them are different out there, right? And everybody likes that. But we don't, and so they don't debate the teaching of Jesus. They don't debate the existence of Jesus. But we live in a very inclusive world where all roads and all ways of life should be treated equally and accepted. Nobody should be left out, and all roads should lead to God. Now I want you to think about that, right? It's not that the world denies the existence of God, they don't, right? What they deny or want to deny is the existence of Jesus Christ and his teachings, right? I mean, I'm supposed to believe that all of the world's religions are basically the same. They're not. They're not. Jesus never said they were the same. And remember, I told you before we got started, I'm not talking to you about religion. I don't care where you came from today. I don't care if you're Baptist. I don't care if you're Pentecostal. I don't care what you are. I'm not interested in talking about religion. I'm interested in talking about Jesus. I mean, that's the exclusive claim that people have problems with. But in John 14, 6, Jesus says, I am the way. I am the truth. And I am the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. That's Jesus' proclaim, right? So if that doesn't line up with your theology or it doesn't line up with your lifestyle, find a church that does. But you're not going to change my mind on who Jesus is because Jesus changed my life. Okay? And there's the problem. That's that exclusive part they don't like. That doesn't include everybody. The Bible doesn't say that. The Bible says if you believe in your heart and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, you will be saved. That's what the Bible says, right? It doesn't say that you can't be accepted because you have a different way of life. It doesn't say that. You and him will have to work all the details out. That's not for me to do, right? But that's the part that the world has the issue with. There may be some good things in other religions of the world. And I'm not here to debate that. I'm just not. I'm a Christian. I'm saved. Not because of my works, but because of the blood of his sacrifice and his grace and his mercy. And the only way to be assured of that for my eternal life and position is through a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what the Bible says. If that doesn't fit with you, move on. Move on. But it lines up just perfectly for me. Right? Because all I had to do was confess Jesus as the Lord of my life. He healed my marriage and all of those other things that he didn't want in my life. He took them from me. Amen. Right? Slowly and steadily. Done the same for you, hadn't he, Marshall? Marshall even parting his hair now. He's looking all cute today. I like it. So I'm not asking you to consider this to be the best church in Pampa. Right? Actually, at one time, we were a real nice little secret, right? So we didn't have to put up with all the nonsense, right? But I'm not asking you to consider us to be the best church in Pampa. I'm not asking you to consider me to be the best pastor in Pampa. I don't really give a rip what you think about me because I'm not here to impress you. I'm here for him. He saved my life, right? I'm asking you to do the same thing, to consider Jesus, right? And so instead of arguing with me and fighting with me, I'm just asking you to turn it over to Jesus. That's it, right? And I don't care what that is in your life. I mean, if you have a marriage you're not happy with, here you go. Here's your answer. You ready? Turn it over to Jesus. Quit fighting with her, right? Turn it over to Jesus. Let him fix it. He will. He fixed mine. Right? If mad at your kids all the time because they won't do right, turn them over to Jesus. He'll fix them. He will. But guess what? You got to quit letting them go, "Well, I don't want to go to church. It's boring and I don't like it." No, you've given in to their nonsense. And guess what? The minute you start that nonsense, it'll be the rest of your life. Right? "I made the decision, Mom, that I made because I don't like the way that y'all do things. It's boring." No, that's called rebellion. That's what that's called. In Mark 2, 16 through 17, I'm almost through. Look at there. And that's the truth. Let me back up. Sorry, I'm hitting the wrong button. But he said in verse 16, he says, "But when the teachers of religious law," the religious people, okay, "who were the Pharisees, saw him eating with tax collectors and other sinners." Got any sinners in the room? Amen. Thanks to all 12 of you for being honest. The rest of you are liars and going to hell. Tell me that nonsense. 12 people raise their hand. I know you. I know you, girl. You better raise that hand now. Huh? You've been coming here a long time. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. I was trying to lighten up the mood. Right? But then he goes on and he says, they ask his disciples, "Why does he eat with this scum?" Who was saying that? The religious people. And in verse 17, Jesus said, he told them, "Healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do. I have come to call those," watch this, I absolutely love this. "I have come to call not those who think they are righteous, but those who know they are sinners." I love those verses, you know, because, I mean, Jesus came for a person like me. I mean, he did. I mean, listen, I wasn't born a pastor. I don't have college. Here's what I have. I have a Lord that qualified the call on my life. That's it. Right? He doesn't do that backwards, right? Let you get all the qualifications and then calls you. He calls you, right? Because you're already qualified. Right? I'm not here to impress anybody but him. I'm not. You know, I don't care what you think about religion. I have my own thoughts about religion. But this is what I know. In all of my brokenness, in all of my bad decisions, right? He chose me. Man, that makes me smile. I mean, I got tattoos too. I do. That's just the only one you can see. You can't see the rest of them. But I'm covered in them, right? I used to cuss, right? Oh, I still get mad every now and then. I do. I'm human, right? But I also know that at some point I have to take responsibility for my actions. Right? I mean, there's part of that, right, that the Lord forgave, right? And so if he forgave it, that doesn't mean I go back to it time and time again. It means it's forgiven. So why the heck would I go back to it again? Right? Because the next time I go back to it, guess where I'm going? It's not the place of forgiveness. It's called the county jail. Right? And then you're sitting there going, "Man, I thought he forgave all that." He did. But you're so smart, you went and picked it up again. But listen, Jesus loved the group that everyone else despised and rejected. I was thinking about this morning, and I told him this morning, if you're perfect, you just keep sitting over there shining your halo. You just keep sitting over there shining your halo. And when the horn blows up yonder, and you look around and you're still shining, and you realize there's nobody left for you, then you'll realize what we already knew. Right? I mean, I really want you to get that into your mind. Because the minute that you get that into your mind, and all of a sudden you understand that this guy, Jesus Christ, if I would just take the book that's written about him and about my life and just open it up. Listen, you don't even have to get serious about reading it. I mean, literally, there's times I let it fall open. Like I go put it down on the table and it falls open. And when it falls open, I read a verse and it took me like 3 seconds to read. And I'm like, wow, that's the God I serve. I mean, he gave me just what I needed this morning. And I didn't even have to work for it. Right? But if I would just do that and believe in my heart and confess from my mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. Right? It doesn't say follow 12 rules. It just says believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord. Right? And then what does Jesus say? He said, well, there's really two commands that are real important, and both of them are pretty much the same. So love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. That's what he says. And what does it say? I'll be saved. Right? There's two things I want you to consider today before we're finished. I want you to consider the resurrection. Not your understanding of the resurrection. Not your version of the resurrection. But the resurrection that said they rolled the stone away and he was gone. The resurrection that said only within a 40-day span after that. I mean, think about that. 40 days. That ain't very long. Right? We make a lot of bad decisions in less time than 40 days. Right? But just 40 days. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people saw him in the flesh. Spoke with him, ate breakfast with him. I know that's hard to comprehend, right? But you're not asked to comprehend it, you're asked to believe it. Right? You're not asked to try to work it all out in your little pea brain up there. You're asked just to believe it. That's what you're asked. The Bible says he was born of a virgin, right? That he was miraculously, that's the word. In other words, it was a miracle. He was miraculously conceived. He did not inherit the sin, that means, this is what that means. He didn't inherit the sin nature of his father. He didn't inherit anything from his father. He was completely, according to the Bible, he was completely without sin. I mean, he had none. He lived a perfect life for us. You can see it all throughout the book. Watch this, Carl. You can't miss this. And the man who had no sin came and said, Carl, just give me yours. Then you won't have any. And I'll die right up there for you. I'll take all of yours. You just give it to me. You'll never have to carry that nonsense again. As a matter of fact, you'll be white as snow. Carl, that means you'll be just like I was, because I'm not that anymore because I took yours, right? You'll be sinless. you'll be sinless. And you know, I start thinking about all of that. I mean, all of that stuff, you know, even the testimonies I've told you on, some of your testimonies, you know, that we've been sharing over the last few months. Yeah, all of that stuff, it's not yours anymore. It's gone. You gave it to Him and He gave you His glory. But that's not all He did. I mean, if that's all that you ever see there, that's great. But I mean, Jesus performed miracles. Right? And he called us to do that as well. I mean, I read the story. It's sad to me sometimes when I read some of those stories, because there's these people that were lepers and they lived in leper colonies. They couldn't live in the city of their birth because they were sick or unclean. They couldn't live in Marshall's hometown because they were unclean. So they created this little place for them right there between the two lands, and that was called the leper colony. And if you had leprosy, that's where you went. Jesus cleansed them, Carl. Think about this. Watch this. He cleansed them, and then he says, Carl says, oh my goodness, goody, 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 I'm cleansed. Lord, I want to go with you. And he said, nah, I don't want you to go with me. I need you to go back to the home that they kicked you out of and show, not tell, show everyone what I did for you. Right? I mean, if you think about that, I mean, at that moment, Jesus, charity, he could have said, no, I need you to come with me, bro. I need some strength. Right? And the only way people are going to believe in me is if you come with me so they can see that you're healed. That's not what he said. Go home and tell others so they may believe. That's what he said. I mean, he healed deaf ears, and he still does that today. He grew back legs. Ain't that right, Judy? Yeah. Yeah. And he still does that today. He hasn't stopped anything. The issue is our belief. And I believe it affects the church today. I just do. You know, and I mean, he was doing all this. We talked about Palm Sunday last week. I mean, you know, they're literally shouting, Hosanna, 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 waving palm branches while he's standing there. And on today or Friday morning, those same people, those same ones, Rachel, they're standing at the foot of the cross. They're standing in the Roman area where they're beating him unmercifully with the intentions of ensuring that he's dead before the sun goes down. Also, they can celebrate their religious day because he's got to be off the cross, right? Yeah. And every one of them are shouting there, crucify him. He did absolutely nothing wrong. But we know the Bible says it had to happen. See, for me, that's where it has to start, Josie, right there. I mean, as the Bible says it has to happen for me. You see that? I mean, it's not just to fix some little stupid thing or for all of us. He did it for me. If nobody else said yes to him, he did it for me. But not to create a religion for me, he did it for me to give me a clean heart. Right? So that I could stand here on Sunday morning and tell people about what he did for me. So that you can go to work on Monday and tell people about what he did for you. Oh, you don't have to stand on a stump and preach a sermon. All you have to do is live it. They'll be drawn to you. Ask my wife. I don't know the last time she preached a sermon. Not in a pulpit. But no matter where she works, it won't take long before somebody starts coming and confessing their sin to her. Not because she's asked them to, but they just start, well, you know why? I mean, it's just, that's what God asked you to do. He called us into a dark world to be light to a dying world. And sometimes, Joel, the only light in your world is through you. And they need that. They need that. All of us do. I mean, they insulted him. They ripped his beard out. They beat him mercifully. And after all of that was done, these are the only words that he could say to everybody. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Folks, that's love. That's love. I want you to consider the eternal message. I mean, I want you to think about it from this perspective. Just get your head wrapped around it, because I've said this before. The minute you say yes to Jesus, you're promised eternal life. And eternal life starts at that moment. Not after you're deceased. It starts at that moment. So your new life in Christ begins at that moment. And the Bible tells us that through sanctification, it's just a process of growing to be more like Christ every day. Right? So it's not an uphill climb. Right? It's an uphill spot to the place you're called to be, which is the head and not the tail. Right? I've told y'all this 1,000 times, and I was telling somebody the other day, I got more promotions in my jobs, after I confessed Jesus Christ as the Lord of my life than I had ever had before. That's honest to God, that's the truth. I ended my secular career as a 6-figure income. I did. Started at the bottom, and when I said yes to the Lord, I mean, there for a little while, I was a manager, and before long, they were calling me sir. That, she knows it. Mister. I mean, that's just getting back what the Lord promised to give to you. It already belongs to you. In Romans 3, Paul says we are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. And this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who you are. No matter who you are. I mean, I'm just going to ask the hard question. Are you, like, really ready? Yeah. No, I mean, like, really ready. Bobby, I already know you're ready. If the horn blew today, Bobby's cane would still be sitting there on the floor. Bobby be gone. Right? I'm not talking about fire insurance. That's not what I'm talking about. I mean, literally ready. I mean, I want you to be so doggone ready for the Lord to come back that you just worship Him every day. But listen, I don't want you just to be ready for that. I want you to be ready for life change, heart change, marriage change, children change. I want you to be ready for all of it. All of it. I don't want you to be sitting in the chair this morning and your heart aching because I'm talking to you and you think, well, maybe next Sunday. You're not promised next Sunday. As a matter of fact, you're not promised another moment. And I can promise you this, if you were sitting in the seat and you were just thinking, maybe I should just go ahead and do it today, and you don't, and He comes back in a minute, or you die in a minute, guess where you go? Thank you, Trudy. Hell, where there's wailing and gnashing of teeth and the unquenchable fire. I literally, exactly what Joseph said this morning, I want you to consider Jesus at all cost. listen, some of your friends are going to call you a nut. But what's crazy is you'll look up before long when you say yes to Jesus and you'll realize I'm not a nut. They are. Because if they knew what I already know, they'd be following the same God that I'm following. Right? I didn't have to work so hard to fix my marriage. The Lord did it. I didn't have to work so hard with my children. The Lord did it. Right? All I had to do was bring them to church. I didn't have to beat them. I just said, listen, you can do whatever you want to do tomorrow and this afternoon. But this morning, no questions. Sunday morning, you get up. You get your clothes on. And you be ready to go when we're ready to go. Is that what we told them? So on Sunday morning when we woke up, we didn't hear that. I didn't want my game. Okay, we'll just stay home and you can watch cartoons all day. No, we didn't do that. I just see Cooper sitting there. Cooper been in the church since before he was supposed to be in the church. Right? And guess where he's going to be the rest of his life? In the church. In the church, because either G going to bring him and my son going to be walking like this, or my son's going to bring him. Right? And if I'll do that and just keep his heart focused on Jesus, I won't have to do anything else. Y'all can stay seated, but here's what I'm fixing to do. We're fixing to open up the altars. I just want you to come. The altars are always open, but I want you to come. If you're like, that's me, I needed to hear that this morning, I want you to come now. Come on, Nelson. Thanks for being honest, Kim. Andrew, you come stand on this side. Andrew thinks, oh boy. Yeah, oh boy. Trudy, you come stand right here. You are Erica. Right there. We're going to take some time and just let people be prayed for. Whatever it is. If you need healing in your physical body, we'll deal with that as well. Terry, you need to go there and wait on Erica. If you want to know that Jesus, the one that didn't count you out, I want you to come now. Today is the time to make a decision. It's life changing. It's life changing. And here's the truth. What have you really got to lose? I mean, think about this. I told him this morning, I saw this years ago, and it was one of those things that spoke so high to me. I say it all the time, Chris. If I die and I'm wrong, yet I have him, I've lost nothing. Right? If you die and you don't have him, you've just been going through the motions, you've lost everything. So you don't have anything that I'm asking you to lose. I'm not asking you to give up something. I mean, listen, and when I stepped over those chairs in that little Pentecostal church, I was a biker, all the way a biker. I can make sailors blush by the way I cussed. My marriage was not good, but we had a house full of stuff, didn't we? When I gave my heart to the Lord, he took my tongue. Right? He changed my marriage. And then he gradually started shrinking the size of my house. And I soon realized that all of those things weren't really blessings from the Lord. They were filling up the empty spaces. That's all they were. They were just filling up empty spots. And when you get the, when you deal with the empty spots, which is what Jesus does, when you deal with those, all of a sudden you can come to church as a new person, right? You come for a different reason. I mean, you can come to worship Him with clarity. Amen. I'm just going to give everybody a minute, and then we're going to we'll close. Give you a final thought. I just kept hearing it inside, just over and over and over. None of this today was about an Easter bunny. It was about Jesus. What you want to do in your private time as it relates to Easter, I'm gonna let you work that out. I'm not here to beat people up about how they celebrate Easter. That's not for me to decide. But what I am telling you is this. Today was about Jesus. And I know beyond a shadow of a doubt. I don't know who, but I know. I know with everything inside of me. There are two men. That's all I'm going to say. Who came today because their wife had just told them, come on and go to church with me. And he finally went, okay. If it'll help, listen to me, it won't help. It won't help. You're lying to yourself, and that's what the devil wants you to believe. It will not help. The only thing that's going to help is when you turn your life over to Jesus Christ. That's it. And if you're living in that house right now believing that something else is good, boy, is it going to fix it? No, it's not. You're lying to yourself. It'll be destroyed in 6 months. Keep sitting there. Keep sitting there, sir. Just keep sitting there. But I'm telling you, if you want what I firsthand experienced at the age of 33 that changed my kids and changed my marriage, come on, right now. Take that quiet moment while we're finishing up that Joseph was singing about. Thank you, big guy. Come on, stand. We will pray over you. Want to pray? Ricky. Nelson's going to pray.
So the word tells us that if we're embarrassed to confess Jesus in front of the people, that Jesus wouldn't claim us in front of the Father. Right? But I will say this, that even after we get ready to leave and we say this prayers and people leave, I'm going to stay. And if anybody feels led to come up and get prayer for their marriage, for their life, listen, the Lord's placed the men where he's placed them at, and he expects the men to carry out that responsibility the way they're supposed to carry it out. So, Heavenly Father, we just thank you for today's service. We thank you for today's word. Holy Spirit, we thank you for working in us and through us. And we thank you. We thank you, Lord, that as we get ready to leave this service today, Lord, that the seed that you have planted in us is going to produce a harvest, Father God. And we thank you for letting your light shine through us and for us, Father God. And we give you all praise, honor, and glory, Father. I just speak the name of Jesus over every person here listening to my voice. I thank you for protecting their homes and their families. I thank you for their blessings, Lord. I thank you for the pruning. I thank you for the sharpening. But most of all, Father God, I just thank you for your presence in each and every single one of us, Father. And I thank you for the work that you're doing in our lives. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen.